like this format, it is the desire for the leagues to inform the voters of where the candidates stand on issues that are very important in this election year. To begin our presentation, we would like to give you a brief background on each of the political candidates. Since 1983, our first Mrs. Hills and her family make their home in Amesbury. Our second candidate, Peter Torkelson, is a native and current resident of Gander, and he is a Republican candidate for the 6th Congressional seat. He is a former state representative. Long acquainted with the North Shore. Mr. Tennant was born and raised in Swampscott, and he and his family currently reside in Lynn. Long involved with politics, Mr. Tennant has served on the Swampscott School Committee and is the former executive director of the State Republican Party. Continues to serve as an adjunct professor of media ethics at Emerson College, a post he has held since 1982. He is also a trained family therapist. A native of Stuttgart, Germany, Mr. Elbart became an American citizen at age 21. Since the mid-70s, Mr. Elbart has acted as a consultant in numerous political campaigns. Former PBD mayor also served on the House Select Committee on Intelligence and is chairman of the Armed Services Subcommittee on Investigation. Congressman Nevrulis and his wife and family reside in Peabody. Our first question for this presentation involves the economy.
To change our federal budget priorities. We have this enormous deficit that grew during the decades of the 80s because the Congress voted for enormous buildup in arms and in defense. And we can no longer afford to be spending $150 billion of our taxpayers' money in Europe, in their economy. It is time for us. And they must be skilled and educated for the jobs of the future. We should invest in rebuilding our crumbling infrastructure, our highways, our roads, our bridges, our telecommunication systems. For if we're going to be strong in the future and have a strong economy, we've got to have an infrastructure system that is strong. We cannot afford things like $118 billion drugs, the inner cities. We can reduce the deficit and address these critical problems here at home in the United States. But we must have people in Congress that are willing to take the tough vote.
Hello, I'm Peter Torkelson. To help improve our economy, we have to look at the number one issue in this campaign, being rebuilding our economy to bring jobs back to our district and to our state. We're at a crossroads now. Included in those are education and protecting the environment. For education, I do not favor a bureaucracy from Washington coming down and telling local schools what to do, yet we do need standards that will be met throughout our country. The future of our country relies in jobs that require a variety of skills, and that means that our educational system is going to be of paramount importance. For improving our environment, I support recycling initiatives, as I did as a state representative, to clean up our environment. I strongly believe as well as prevent pollution in the future. And finally, to help protect our environment, we have to look at source reduction. We have to remove waste from the stream before it ever gets to our landfills. By taking these steps in education and protecting our environment, we can help make America a better place.
As I travel across the 6 congressional districts from Lynn to Havel and Bedford to Mizzou, just to pay the interest on our national debt. Those are funds that don't go to help any human being, any program, or any individual. As we continue to spend $1 billion a day, more than we bring in as a government, average working people understand we have a problem. In the last 30 years, there's been 56 tax increases, yet we've only balanced our budget once. We need a balanced budget amendment, without question. Yet my two Democratic opponents have said we don't need a balance. The last 20 years, increasing taxes a dollar, they increased spending $1.28. You couldn't run your home, you couldn't run anything that way. We need to change that. What I would do is get spending under control, put incentives in to create economic growth, the capital gains reductions, investment tax credits for small businesses. I am a small businessman, and I can tell you what companies need today, particularly small businesses that employ 6 out of 10 people today, that represent 38% of the gross national product. What they need is credit, loans, so they can generate jobs. Reinvesting in education will be our number one priority on the domestic front. Thank you.
As a country, we have to set priorities. We have to set the priorities that allow our economy to grow again, that maintain our national character, and that also maintain a presence within the world that is not exaggerated. It is most important, though, that we create the kind of economic underpinning that will allow us to continue to be both a civilized society within and a growing society throughout the world. Most important right now is the understanding that the losses and gains of pushing problems into the future, of not dealing with our economic problems, that gain is what's destroying this country. Paul Tsongas is the only candidate that addressed the real needs of this country, and my candidacy is a reflection of his candidacy. The idea of economic truth-telling and beginning to clear up the kind of problems that are destroying the livelihood of our children, destroying the fiber of our country, and the kind of problems that limit our options all around. It is easy to talk about increasing number of officers in the future. We have to do all of these, but we're going to be able to do none of them well unless we start addressing the economic problems that underlie the whole pattern.
I think in view of the problems we're going through at the present time, certainly with the economic stagnation, we've got to learn to reprioritize, along with what you have mentioned in your question to me. I think that we would be most responsible if we would pay attention to the budget deficit so that our children and grandchildren do not pay for it in the future. By reprioritizing, I strongly believe that we have to make the greatest investment of all, and that would be in the field of education. What we must do is take a hard look, find out where we're going wrong, fund very, very properly, and increase funding rather than decrease funding in education for the true investment for the future. And by the way, when we talk about education, we also must talk about drug education. Rather than the 70% of $13 billion that is now going to law enforcement and military interdiction on the war on drugs, which is a real serious problem for each and every family in this country, I would like to see reprioritized about maybe 80% of the $13 billion for education and treatment in the drug areas and 20% for law enforcement. If we do that, now you're making a proper investment in education. You're also getting back the fiber that has held this country back for the fiber that's driven this country for many, many years. Also, let us not forget that although we have a staggering economy, we've got to do something about the budget deficit, and I think we can constrain some spending without hurting the vital areas. The investment of the future is jobs, education, proper investment, and the environment. I would hope that we can get the attention of those in Congress to make these reprioritized areas.
Our second question regards campaign finance. What is your position on campaign finance reform? Specifically, the Congressional Campaign Spending and Election Reform Act.
I support campaign finance reform. I think it's important for our electoral process. In recent years, political action committees have grown far too much in influence in Washington, D.C. Under current law, PACs can give up to $10,000, $5,000 for a primary and $5,000 for a general election, to a candidate. And I think that greatly exaggerates the influence that they should have. I personally have taken a pledge not to accept PAC money in this congressional race or any congressional race because I think the influence of PAC has grown far too much. To help reduce that influence, I would support legislation eliminating PAC contributions for all congressional candidates and requiring them to look for small contributors in their district primarily, but throughout the country if they wish, to help support their campaign. I would support a voluntary system of public financing where small contributions would be matched voluntarily from a tax deduction form similar to funding for the presidential election. In addition to that, I think that we have to look at many of the perks that go along with incumbency. Those perks include such things as cost of living pay increase, even though congressmen make $129,000 a year, includes free picture framing, and also includes the right to send out almost an unlimited amount of free mail. My favor for killing those perks so that incumbents do not have an unfair advantage going into an election. Certainly no incumbent.